Leadership of this church, we welcome all of you to our worship service. And I can see almost everyone fanning themselves. With that, may we also feel the warmth of fellowship here in. Also, we'd like to express appreciation to those who, in spite of not being able to come to PIC, they are listening over the radio. For the new students, we are tuned. If you tune in to 87.8, that's the radio station of our campus, of our university. So if ever you, and we hope you won't get sick, but if ever, you can still listen to the service of our church through that station. Anyway, there are some of our brothers and sisters who, for the first time, or probably they have visited PIC once again. They wrote their names in our guest book, but I believe there are more. But let me mention them. First, we have Luz Vimin Kalimlim. I think this is from California. Can we request you to stand up? Okay. Anyway, welcome to PIC. Also from, well, this one is from Papua New Guinea, Caroline Sogavo. I'm sorry. Can we request you to stand up as well? Sister Caroline. Anyway, welcome to PIC. Next is, we've missed this couple. They're coming from Africa. Sister Cora and Brother Vic Banyaga, can we request you to stand up? We're very glad that you joined us. Oh, they're over there. Thank you very much for joining us in today's worship. Dr. Cora used to be Vice President for Finance, and we're very glad that they are here with us. Next is Salcor Quines from Michigan. Can we request you to stand up as well? Okay, welcome. And next is from Abu Dhabi, Marmi Telin Adlawan. Can you please stand up? Anyway. Oh, there she is. Thank you. Thank you. And last but not the least, from New Jersey, Manalungsung family. Okay, there they are. Thank you for joining us. And I believe, again, as I've mentioned, there are more of you, but you did not find the time. You weren't able to find the time to write in our guest book. Probably you're embarrassed to write your name here, but you're all welcome to our worship service this morning. And with that, can we now extend a warm handshake to those seated beside us, behind us, and in front of us? Can we do that? Especially to those persons that I've mentioned. Especially, oh, well, that goes as well with those who are there at the balcony. Thank you. Now, before I continue, may I now request those who are seated or those who are standing at the back, please, you may now start looking for a place where you can be more comfortable. Although I can see that we're now full packed. Now, there are some announcements here that we'd like you to take note of. First, once again, let me mention that if you have plans, again, if you have plans not related with the Sabbath, please take note of this. Our sunset schedule today is at 6:19 p.m. Okay, once again, sunset today is at 6:19 p.m. So again, if you have plans not related with the Sabbath, please take note of that. Remember that. Another announcement here, for our fellowship lunch today, after the service, Barangay Matyaga will be hosting the fellowship lunch, and it will be here at the Mother's Room. Next Sabbath, Barangay Kalat-Kalat will be hosting the fellowship lunch. Next one, may we remind all of the Sabbath school teachers again, and even if you're not a Sabbath school teacher, you are welcome to attend. Every Friday from 6 o'clock to 7 p.m., or from 6 to 7, we are having our Sabbath school lesson preview. Again, even if you're not a Sabbath school teacher, but if you are a Sabbath school teacher, please come. So it is from 6 to 7 here at the Mother's Room. This afternoon, we invite you for our first AY service this semester. So the theme that the AYPC or AY Programming Committee made is, it's all about youth. So it's going to be at 2 o'clock. Please come. This will be our first AY service this semester. And last from the announcements, if you are a deacon, can you see the hands of the deacons? Our deacons, we will have, or you will have, a meeting this afternoon at 2 p.m., 2 o'clock, here at the Mother's Room. Okay? So if you will be attending the fellowship lunch and you are a deacon, don't leave anymore. You stay so that many will be able to attend the meeting. So again, deacons, please, this is a very important meeting. Please do come. Now, as I've mentioned, this is the last of the announcement, but let me share this, brothers and sisters. Since this is the first Sabbath of the semester, let me emphasize this once again. Some of you probably have been hearing me about this, and please don't get tired listening to me about this matter. So lend me your ears. This is a serious one. First, let me start with saying, whenever we come here, what is our purpose? Let me ask you that. What is our purpose? Is it to display something to our friends? We are here to worship, right? We're here to worship. And who do we worship? Do we worship our gadgets? Do we worship our friends? No. Who do we worship? We worship God, right? Now, friends, when it's worship time already, can we put our cell phones on silent mode? Or if our gadgets, if we are not using our iPad or our tablet for worship purposes, like if we have our Bibles there, if they're not for worship purposes, can we turn them off? Okay? And the next one is a more serious one. We are really hoping that you won't come here wearing your little sister's dress. Or you did not pay the tailoring that much or that enough money, so they also economized with the fabric. I hope you know what I am talking about. more skin shown here in church is not good. There's time for that in your private homes, but this is God's house. So here, God would prefer that we won't take away the attention of people away from Him, so that when people worship here, their minds are tuned in, their eyes are tuned in to the message or to the speaker, and not to your shoulders, to your lower neckline, or to your legs. That goes with the men. If your jeans and your t-shirt is your best worship attire, that's okay with me. That's fine with us. But I believe there that next Sabbath, you can have a better worship attire than that. So can we have that now as a commitment this coming semester, that when we come to church, we will wear our best for the Lord. Amen? Thank you very much. Now for our worship leaders. First, the prelude will be offered to the Lord by Sister Salome Melanie Rain Velasco. She will also be doing the offertory music. And our song leader this morning is Brother Israel Villaver, a music major student. And we will be accompanied on the organ by Sister Cheryl Ann De Dios, one of the faculty of the music department. Our presiding elder is Brother Winifredo Paez, the Vice President for Student Services. Well, that goes for those who don't know him, but I guess especially the new students, you have encountered him, especially during the interviews. The scripture reading will be led to us by Sister Dorina May Ferry, an education student, senior education student, major in English. And the pastoral prayer will be led to us by Brother Joymart Bonete, a third-year theology student. The musical offering will be offered to the Lord, and to prepare our hearts and minds for the message by Marinelle Joy Sabala, Wilhelm Fesalbon, and John Elaine Saba, ladies trio. Brothers and sisters, this morning we're glad that to share with us God's word to break the bread of life for us today, we have none other than our university president, Pastor Francisco D. Gayoba, and let us hope and pray that God's Spirit will dwell in our hearts and in our minds as we listen to the message this morning entitled, Remember While You Are Young. May God bless us.
Come to me is God's invitation to all of us. All who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Matthew 11:28-30. Let's thank the Lord for the good health and strength and for God's invitation to come to him and rest. We are here together. We are here gathered together to worship him and to give adoration into our Creator, our God. So in response to his invitation, let's have a reverent atmosphere that the Holy Spirit will be with us, that will join us in worshiping him. This morning, let's listen attentively and reverently as our speaker, Dr. Gayoba, will remind us of God's goodness while we are young. God bless us all.
Shall we kneel?
Holy, 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 holy is our God. Holy, 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 holy
be seated.
For our thoughts of meditation this morning, I shall be reading from the Acts of Apostles, chapter 58, page 600. It says, Christ has given to the church the secret charge. Every member should be a channel through which God can communicate to the world the treasures of his grace, the unsearchable riches of Christ. There is nothing that the Savior desires so much as agents who will represent to the world his spirit and his character. There is nothing can the world need so much as the manifestation through humanity of the Savior's love. All heaven is waiting for men and women through whom God can reveal the power of Christianity. May the Lord God bless us as we worship him today.
Please rise.
We love thy Sabbath, Lord, and worship at thy will. Oh, may these hours with peace afford and deeper faith instill. Christ's love that sealed this sacred day, a sign that all may understand we own thy sovereign sway.
O Lord our God, creator of heaven and earth, Lord of the Sabbath, we rejoice that you have called us again to worship you. And today, as we lift our voices in thanksgiving and praise, as we listen to your word, and as we open our hearts and our lives to the continuing presence of the Holy Spirit, may we again this Sabbath be saved, be sanctified, be transformed, and may we have a sense of your presence so overwhelming that we get out of this house of worship excited and passionate to serve you. Thank you so much again for your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God is indeed wonderful, for he has extended our lives up to this wonderful moment for us to praise and worship and honor him. To continue our worship, shall we sing, Come Thou Almighty King.
Come Thou Almighty King, help us thy name to sing, help us to praise. Father, all glorious, or all victorious, come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come thou incarnate Word, thy the mighty sword, our prayer attend. Come and thy people bless, and give thy word success. Spirit of holiness on us descend. Come, Holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear. In this glad hour, thou who almighty art, now rule in every heart, and hear from us depart, Spirit of power. To thee, great one in three, eternal praises be, hence evermore thy sovereign majesty may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore.
All glory, Lord, and honor.
All glory, Lord, and honor to thee, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. Thou art the King of Israel, thou David's royal son,
Lord's name cometh, the King, the Blessed One. The company of angels are praising thee on high. Thine mortal men and all things created make reply. The people of the Hebrews with palms before thee wend. Our prayers and prayer and anthems before thee we present. To thee before thy passion they sang their hymns of praise. To thee now high exalted our melody we raise. Thou didst accept their praises, accept the praise we bring. Who in all good delightest, a good and gracious King.
For our scripture reading, let us open our Bible to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, verse 6 and 7. I'll be reading in the New King James Version. Again, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 6 and 7. It says, "Remember your Creator before the silver cord is loosed, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the well. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it." May we all be blessed as we ponder upon this text.
Please kneel.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Our great God, Father in heaven, we would like to thank you and praise you, Lord, because you are great and your works to us is manifested, that we experience your love every day and every moment. And we know that you are a good God that is doing everything for us. But in this moment, Lord, we are asking for the power of the Holy Spirit to be with each one of us. May the Spirit works to us so that we will be more prepared to accept your message to each one of us. And we also come to you, Lord,
We know that we commit sin. Sometimes we are doing it again and again. And sometimes we are just a hypocrite. And because you are the only one who knows our hearts, who knows our struggles, who knows our joy, we're coming to you for the forgiveness of all of our sins that we have committed against thee. We thank you, Lord, because we have this privilege to come to you to be cleansed and to be righteous because of Jesus' righteousness. We thank you also, Lord, for this privilege because we have this Sabbath, that we will experience your presence. And because of this, we are asking, Lord, that we will experience also what is the true essence of the Sabbath, that we will have rest, and we will experience your presence, we will have peace, joy, and we will experience blessed because you blessed this Sabbath day. But in this moment, Lord, we are also praying for all of the Seventh-day Adventists all around the world. May your presence be with them also. As we celebrate, may you help us to grow in grace and also to grow in our communion, in our connection with you. We especially pray for, Lord, for the messenger that you sent us this morning, Pastor Gayoba, as speak to us. May he speak not according to might nor by power, but according to the Holy Spirit. So that we are pleading, Lord, that you use his lips so that it will speak according to your leadings, so that you can reach our hearts, Lord, and also we will learn, each one of us, and we will increase again our faith and our connection with you. You know all of us, Lord. You know our hearts. You know how to reach us. We're praying for our speaker as speak to us. May you cleanse us, Lord, and you know we will know what's your message for us, and we will become not the same person again. Lord, please help us to have a transformation of our character. And also this church will grow in grace and also in our faith. Thank you, Lord, for everything. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Where high the heavenly temple stands, the house of God not made.
Thank you so much for the special number, young ladies. A happy Sabbath to each one of you. It's a pleasure to see all of you here. Many of you are here for your first worship service here in PIC. Yesterday, we welcomed a new student during the convocation, and we are happy that we have younger brothers and sisters who joined our church family starting this semester. I also see a lot of guests and parents, and thank you so much for joining us. I see two presidents of our alumni associations in the United States, AWESNA, Dr. Bangloy and his party, and also Dr. Kines and his party. So thank you for joining us. You know, last weekend was the inaugural celebrations of the Doctor of Medicine program, and the Lord had blessed us. This morning, I want to talk about college years, 16 to 21. Am I right? Or are there 15 to 41? 16 to 21 next year, it will be 18 to 23. I don't know whether my computations will be right. Starting next year, when grade 11 opens, college years will be 18 to 23 and above. College years, what wonderful years they are. I graduated more than 3 decades ago from college. And even now when I see my college friends, my roommates, wonderful memories of college years and the challenges and the fun we had together spill into my consciousness. There's so much good memories of PUC or Adventist University, and especially this campus, and not just the old campus, in my psyche. Yes, the wonderful years of youth, of college, the choicest days of human life. It's also the period or the years where the most critical life tasks are decided or prepared for. Choosing a college, and you are here. Choosing a life calling and vocation. I hope there will be very few of our students who will be jumping from one course to another. Moving away from home for the first time. I heard some of our freshmen are not here today because after 1 week they got so homesick and they went back home just for the weekend. Finding work, few years after college. Making independent financial decisions. Buying, if you have money, or renting a home. Choosing and maintaining church commitments. Forging new friendships and relationships with members of the opposite sex. Embracing the potential for singleness. Are there some of you who have already decided to remain single? Deciding for singleness or for marriage. I believe many of you have enrolled starting last semester, 12 units, preparing for marriage, finding a life partner 101. And parenting. These are wonderful, heady years of early adulthood, or some sociologists would call emerging adulthood. Yes, young people, you are and will be making these important decisions in the context of your generation the next few years. This morning, let me begin our reflection by a little awareness of the exercise of the times you and I are living in. How many of you were born 1980 to 2000? Will you please raise your hands? 1980, raise it higher. 1980 to 2,000. Don't look around on those who were born earlier. Just raise your hands. Okay. 1980 to 2000. Your generation is what sociologists would call the millennial generation. You know, every generation has a name. The name of your generation is Generation Y. We were Generation X. We are X-rated, you are Y-rated. Generation Y, born 1980 to 2000. A generation primarily shaped by the computer boom. I've read some studies, Filipino sociologists that are saying, for us here who are Filipinos, the millennial generation, the beginning date should be moved maybe 5 years later, 1985, because the computer boom arrived in the Philippines a little bit much later. There might be some truth to it. The millennials, you are called. Those of you who raise your hands, what characterizes the youth? You are the youth of the millennial generation or Generation Y. I subscribe to Time Magazine, and on May 20, 2013, Time Magazine released this issue. The me generation. That's what Joel Stein, a journalist, after his extensive study, called your generation. Our generation was the me generation. And your generation is the me. Maybe that's an indication. If we are signal number one, me, you are signal number three, me. Me generation. Joel Stein began the article, and listen carefully, I'm not going to project it, with these words. He said, I am about to do what old people like your president have done throughout history. Call those younger generation, younger than me, he was a generation, lazy, entitled, selfish, and shallow. But he said, I have studies, I have statistics, I have quotes from respective academics. Unlike my parents, my grandparents, and my great-grandparents, I have proof, he said, when he wrote this article, that the millennials can be called me generation. And he's correct. When I look at the article, he was not talking about theories of what these young people may be. What he was summarizing there are studies. And when I check other documents, I also wanted to know, is this also true to Filipinos? It's easy for me to say, not me, not us. Then I discovered that many Filipino sociologists and psychologists also say that indeed, what this author is saying about the millennial generation can also be said to a great extent for Filipinos. You know, they have a term for Filipino millennials. They call it Phil-millennials. They have a term. What did Joel Stein, the author of this Time Magazine article, say about you, about this generation? I'm generalizing now. This is what he said about this generation. He had a little illustration. I put together two pages there together. All of these captions, we will enlarge it later. Look at them all sitting on their own. That's what united the millennial generation. The tablets, the laptops, the phablets? Yeah? That's what united this generation. This is what he said about this generation. The millennials are a generation mostly of teens and 20-somethings, known for constantly holding up cameras, taking pictures of themselves, and posting them online. Oh, he did not mention the cell phone. Taking pictures of themselves and constantly posting them online. I had dinner with a young person. He was taking pictures of what we were eating. And even before he put down his spoon, he said, it's already on Facebook. What he was about to eat in the restaurant, it's already on Facebook. No wonder when he was entering the restaurant, he was asking the receptionist, is there Wi-Fi here? Is there Wi-Fi here? I think he wanted to show his friends in the Philippines this what he was eating there in the United States. You know, he was coming from here and showing his friends here. Iniinggit siguro tayo, ano, what he was eating there. This is what Stein mentioned about the millennial generation. I think my remote, it doesn't belong to the millennial generation. It's inefficient. This is what he wrote. What are the characteristics of the millennial generation? Let me read to you what he wrote. The incidence of narcissistic personality disorders is nearly 3 times as high for people in their 20s as for the generation that's now 65 or older, according to the National Institutes of Health. 58% more college students scored higher on narcissism scale in 2009 than in 1982. Millennials got so many participation trophies growing up that a recent study showed that 40% believe they should be promoted every 2 years, regardless of their performance. What is narcissism, young people? The dictionary definition of narcissism, or being a narcissist, is this: excessive interest in oneself and one's physical appearance. How do you... Is that the way? When you take pictures, you must frame your natural asset. Maybe you need this. Excessive interest in one's physical appearance. Synonyms in the dictionary: vanity, self-love, self-admiration, self-absorption, self-obsession, conceit, self-centeredness, self-regard, egoism. If you go to the dictionary of psychology, they have another definition. They have a similar or a more nuanced definition of a narcissist. What is a narcissist? Extreme selfishness with a grandiose view of one's own talents and a craving for admiration as characterizing a personality type. Stein writes in another part of his article that millennials, Generation Y, needs constant approval. He says, they are fame-obsessed. 3 times as many middle school girls want to grow up to be a personal assistant to a famous person. Because even though they don't have a high position, at least they are connected to somebody famous. Millennials, Stein would say, are so convinced of their own greatness that the National Study of Youth and Religion found that the guiding morality, this is how they make decisions, that the guiding morality of millennials in any situation is that if they feel good, it must be right. If it's okay, it feels nice, it must be right. So their basis of deciding what is right from wrong is that it feels good. What advertising is there? It feels good. If it feels good, just do it. I forgot now. I read an advertisement a few months ago about it. The author would continue, their development is stunted. More and more people graduating from college stay with their parents and would not work. That's why maybe that's the reason why he said they're lazy. And in fact, he said, 80% of people under 23, when they graduated from college, said they wanted that one day they will have a job with great responsibility. 10 years later, only 60% actually took a job with great responsibility. Many of them keep on changing jobs. One of the characteristics of the millennial generation, social scientists would say, is what they call entitlement. Entitlement. What is entitlement? You have there the title in the middle. What is entitlement? Entitlement is a state of mind in which an individual comes to believe that privileges should be made rights. Let me go slow. A privilege is actually a right. They are confused with what is a privilege from what is a right. That they are expected to receive those privileges because to them, it's a right. They can demand it rather than think of it according to the dictionary definition. It's merely a privilege, may or may not be given. Therefore, there are several issues. There's a lack of personal responsibility. They want to demand what they have not worked for, but they demand it. Demand a higher grade, even though they have not actually studied hard. Because maybe for them, a higher grade is a right, rather than a privilege and something to achieve. There's the inability to accept that actions have consequences. If you want to be successful, you must do certain things as a result of your decision. It's hard for them to connect that what happens in the future is a result of what you do today. Yes, young people, because of this, there's so much dependency in this generation. What can we say to this generation? Again, this is a generalization. You may or you may not be totally characterized by what I mentioned. As I said, I read some of the studies about Filipino millennials. They discovered that Filipino millennials are more conservative when it comes to relationships. They are not so, what they call them, free spirits when it comes to morality. They understand more that the moral choices that you make will determine your future. And it is good. This morning, you have heard the text that we have chosen. The text says, remember your Creator. Remember your Creator. And that is a major thing that we want to address this morning. What is the summary of what Joel Stein in the Time magazine said? Why was he afraid for your generation? He said that the self-centeredness of the millennial or Generation Y generation could bring about the end of the civilization that we know. Why? At the core of this civilization is the spirit of sacrifice and self-giving. Self-forgetfulness. That is the core of what brings families together, marriages strong, and commitment to a work ethic, even though sometimes there are conflicts in the workplace. Thus, the command for us to remember is very, very important. The Bible says, remember while you are young. I am quoting the New Living Translation. Let me go back to the previous slide. This generation has also strengths, and these are your strengths. You find new and better ways of doing things. That's good. You do not follow the conventions. You want to find and discover new ways of doing things. Many millennials are earnest and optimistic. And many of them, if not most of them, are pragmatic idealists, tinkerers, we would say, more than dreamers. You want to make things happen. But as we already mentioned, the Bible says, remember the Lord, your Creator, while we are young, while you are young. Remember the text? Or maybe we should look at the text again. I'm not using my Bible now because this is a different version. But if you have your Bible, why don't you open to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 6. And then we will use the translation that was used. Remember your Creator. And you, the New Living Translation would insert, while you are young. It's in the old King James too. And then it continues, remember your Creator before the silver cord is loosed, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the well. Brothers and sisters, young people, Generation Y, this is a reminder for all of us. Remember God while you're young. Why? We don't exactly know what this means. Before the silver cord of life snaps, or and the golden bowl is broken. But young people, it may mean that because the silver and the gold is mentioned there, it may mean that even if you are wealthy, someday whatever you do now will cost you and will be harvested, and death will come. The text also says, don't wait until the jar is masked. Many commentators would say that the jar is a simple earthen jar. It talks about what is fragile and what is common. Even the helpless, even the poor, even those who are fragile cannot escape the consequences of life, and therefore should also think about death as the end of life. It alludes to the pool. It mentions about the pulley broken at the well. Yes, this may refer to the strong, those of you who are strong, the utilitarian type of person. Still, no matter how scientific and how good you are in forecasting things, the causes has effects, and ultimately, death can take place. This is the challenge for us. Young people, I have learned as a student that of history and observation from life, that one cannot escape your historical conditioning. Whether you like it or not, you were born between 1980 to 2000. And the characteristics of your generation that we just mentioned briefly has an effect on you. But does it mean that because you were born in that generation, you are destined to reap those consequences? Is it possible that you can be different? How many of you believe that you can be different and you do not need to be enslaved by the cultural factors of your generation? May I see your hands? Thank you. Yes, there is hope, especially we believe that we are Christians. Yes, what we see, what we read, the culture around us have an impact on the way we think and how we act. But by God's grace, you can be different. That's why the Bible says we must remember our Creator in the days of our youth, when we are young. Remember could mean be mindful, be conscious, be aware that you grew up in a generation with certain propensities, with certain tendencies, with certain values. Be aware so that you do not unconsciously or just without any decision follow what others are doing. Be mindful, pay attention, be critical, and reflect about the present and its consequences. Mindful is a nice term. I was tempted to use mindfulness, but then much of the movement that mentions about being mindful is rooted in Buddhist presuppositions. That's why we have a little problem with it. But in simple terms, I would like to say, be mindful. You are young. You live in this world. Well, even though we are here on campus, you just switch on your computer, your cell phone, the influence of the context of the world, of your culture, of your generation is already there. We cannot escape it. But you can remember, you can be mindful that you have a greater purpose in life than just following what others are doing. You can remember God when you are young.
Be mindful, young people. Why is it so? Why should you pay attention and not just be carried with what's happening around us? Why should we be critical and say, is that good? If it's good, I'll follow it. If that's not good, it's not in the Bible, I will not follow it. I will run away from it. The consequences are no good. And you must reflect. I have been doing this for a while. What does it really mean? What are the consequences of this habit in my life? In my marriage, the future? What will my future wife think? What will my children be like because I, their future father, is now acting in a certain way and developing these habits? Young people, whatever you sow, you shall reap. Be mindful. Remember. And in certain ways, and in view of the millennial context, your generation, let me remind you a few things of what we should be mindful about. Young people, be mindful, because much of the millennial generation are what sociologists call shallow. You see the term there? Shallow. Mababaw. They do things, but there is no good basis for what they're doing, except they see it in TV. They're being manipulated by the advertisers, by the companies, for commercial purposes. But because it is there on TV or on the internet or on the Facebook and others are doing it, then they follow it. This is not the first time that young people do it. I was a victim of that too. I remember when I was growing up in high school. Some of you will remember. In the 70s, the style was the pants should be wide. Remember the pants that are bell-bottom? The most popular classmate in our class was the one whose pants are narrow below the hips and the widest flaring towards the ground. That's the most popular person. We call it bell bottom, right? It's like really a bell. And so he would strut across the room and then the bottom would flap. Oh, the girls would, wow. 5 years later, so I tried to have bell bottom. 5 years later, I don't know who changed it. Was it the advertiser? Was it a fashion company? I don't exactly know. I was too naive. I was just following what I see. The style became baston. You know baston? A cane, straight cut. So I brought all my bell-bottom pants of high school glory. I was already in college and brought it to the tailor. And I said, the tailor, make it as straight as possible, as tight as possible on the ankle. And so the tailor did. I have some pants that I was not able to bring to the tailor. I had no other pants one day and I wore it. And my friend in college said, Kiko, ano ba yan? What's that? How come you're still wearing those pants? You know, it's so funny when you're young, you don't really know. What difference does it make when your pants is wide or straight or what? 3 years later, I don't exactly know why the fashion changed. The style was not narrow at the ankle anymore, but it now became the traditional straight cut. So I said, I will bring to the tailor my pants. So I brought it to the tailor, and the tailor said, Anak, son, it's already too narrow. How can we stretch it and make it straight? You know, all of these funny things that go back and forth, we have all these fashions and all these reasons and all the hairstyle and all those. Many of the decisions and give young people sleepless nights, they have to fight with their parents because of this or that, are actually shallow. Are you aware of that? Shallow. There's no physical reason. There is no health reason. It's just that that's the fashion. And fashion trend, the fashionista said so, and we follow. So shallow. Another sociologist called the decision-making delusional, meaning the decisions in life are just based on a delusion. It's not based on reality. You know, that no matter what kind of person this lady is, as long as you're in love, no matter you already see the weaknesses, your parents advise you against it, you say, I'm in love, we are in love, we will be happy forever. The parents would sometimes say, anak, you're delusional. Your choices, your selection is not based on reality. Many young people make decisions as if everything is a miracle, that there is no law of behavior, no laws of science, as if you can just smoke and take drugs, and the next 50 years of your life, you will forever remain healthy, as if there's no such thing as results or consequences. Yes, young people, that is the danger of youth, more so in your generation. And this is a problem. I know many of you are angry with the administration. I'm not defending the administration. Huh? Many of you are angry. Why are we telling you so many things? This, 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 that, that. I remember we reported to your parents, the constituency, of this and the rules. Why is it that the public safety department has a very low score in the ratings when they have a survey? They ask, why do you have a low score for the public safety department? Then we said, because we implemented the dress code. We implemented the study period. We implemented the limits of your children going in and out. One parent said, oh, good. Very good. Then I told them, are you aware that your children are getting angry with us? They said, ignore our children. Never mind them, he said. We want to have those rules. Young people, even though I'm not president, I will tell you the same thing. You have to be aware, and let me read to you what we know as teachers all along. Even when you are 22, 23, it may be that you have your values, but your body, I don't have much time to explain about how the neurons mature and they're interconnected. The prefrontal cortex, the area of the brain which is responsible for what is called executive action, such as goal setting, priority setting, planning, organization, and impulse inhibition, is only fully developed in your early 20s. In other words, when you think you make wise decisions and you just follow what others say, what your friends say, and you do not want to listen and consider and be mindful that you are young, you have to be careful because it's your life. Your brain may not actually be ready to make such decisions. Be mindful, young people. You know what happens when decisions are made coming from urges? Oh, when you're a college student, the hormones surge. the hormones, both male, more male, less female. The hormones surge. What's going to happen for your future, to your future, when someday you look back and said, oh no, I did not make a wise decision. I did not think with my head. I only thought with my hormones. Be mindful, young people. Be mindful. Remember, the days of youth are days of peculiar temptation. We face the same temptations, more so in your time on another level. I want to confess to you the foolishness of youth. No record? The foolishness of youth. When I was younger, I thought, I will never make big mistakes in my life. That's what I thought. Then as I grew older, I realized, I'm not as strong and holy and upright. I'm not a superman that I can resist my urges alone. I need help. I need prayer. I need to be mindful. I need to be careful. But sad to say, you only realize that when you're a little bit older. And by then, Thank God if the mistakes that have been made are only superficial wounds, abrasions. But there are wounds that are it takes a long time to heal. Some wounds and mistakes can be corrected. Some wounds and mistakes cannot be corrected. And it will be in the next lifetime when God will change our bodies and revise our memories that all of the wrong decisions that had been made can be forgotten and corrected. Some may not even be corrected at all because it's part of our identity already. And if God will touch that part of our brain where that mistake connected to our identity is, located, we might have Alzheimer's in heaven because we will forget who we are and how the Lord had saved us. Yes, young people, be mindful of your life. Be mindful of your life because many of the millennials, your generation, are credulous, easy believing young people, primarily informed by social media and follow popularity and cultural images. The values are not based on a permanent worldview such as the Bible, but from peers. I don't know whether it's true today. When I was in college, one of my roommates had a crush and he wants to start courting. Instead of asking, is this lady okay? What are her characteristics? I think what he did was he started asking his barkada and he took a vote. If the barkada approved, go ahead. If the barkada did not approve, no. His problem was most of the barkada disapproved, but still he liked the girl. So he said, can we vote again? What is the basis of your decision? Is it only among friends? What is the basis of your decision? Is it because of self-centeredness, sensuality? Dangerous tendencies, my young friend. Be mindful that you are young. There are risks in the major decisions of life that you make if you do not base it on a firm basis. There's another reason, and this is the last reason that I will ask you to consider this morning. Be mindful of your Creator when you are young. Because the days of youth are of peculiar value, it doesn't happen again. Remember, I don't know whether we have it in here now. I'm not really sure. In Baisa, we have that sign in JS. Students, what's that sign? Right? You will only pass this way, but once. That today is of value. Be careful with your decisions. The best time to form and develop the right attitudes and habits are only a few years. Many of your parents, many of us in our generation, who form bad habits, I have some of them. I developed it when I was younger. I wish somebody told me when I was younger, you improve this. I wish somebody mentored me when I was a young leader. This is a habit that you have to overcome early in your ministry, in your life. It is not a strength, it's a weakness. It's of value because you young people are in your formative years. You must develop the right habits and you must avoid life-threatening and risky habits. Yes, the years of your youth are of value. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. And young people, I want to challenge you today. You have the greatest potential, especially if you remember your Creator, to make the best, the most out of your life. Do you believe that God has a plan for you? Do you believe that God has a plan for you? That's why the term there is Creator. God made you, and He did not only make you, but He created you with a plan. True, Adam and Eve were created 2,000, more than 2,000, oh, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 years ago. But God continues to support you. God knows you personally, and God sustains you. God is no ruler who wrote a book of policies 6,000 years ago, or let's put it 5,000 years ago, and gave it to Moses. And then he said, follow it. And then he went back to heaven and he said, I leave you there. You do whatever you want. Make sure that you follow the policies. 2,000, 6,000, 7,000 years later, I will come back and I make sure and I will judge whether you follow it or not. No, young people, the God who gave us the Bible, the God who told us what is right from wrong, the God who defined for us the path to happiness, the way to pleasures forevermore, is a living God. If you welcome Him to your life, are you aware of that? The Holy Spirit will guide you on what to do. I'm asking my wife now to close her ears. Many years ago in this campus, I liked a girl. You need to close your ears now, Ying. I was graduating from college, and I had to pray and pray and pray, Lord, is it time or not? And I prayed and I prayed. I was graduating. You know, I had senior panic. I prayed and prayed because I believed that God can speak to me more than what I see, more than I can weigh. There's no Urim and Thummim. I prayed and prayed and prayed. And the Lord did not answer. Then I realized that in my life, whenever God has a direction for my life, He wanted me to be a pastor, I knew it. I heard it. There's no doubt about it. The Lord did not say anything to me at the time. What did I get? Because God guides. Unless God says yes or no, when there is no answer, you have to wait before you get instructions. You just have to continue where you are and wait for instructions from God. The instructions of a yes came 8 years after college. Very long. I hope it doesn't have to be that long for you. But the instructions, the word of a yes, this is the girl. Now you can listen. This is the woman. It came much, much later. Young people, are you confused? Are you discouraged? Are you weak? Are you struggling with addictions? If you remember your Creator God can give you the power to overcome, to be a different person, to rise above your difficulties. Lord, you said, I said many times, Lord, I grew up in a dysfunctional home. I need to change my thinking. Please change me. Even now, I still pray that because many times the recording that you get from when you're a child, still sometimes, I don't know when and how and why, sometimes it replays in very, very embarrassing moments. But we have to pray because God can give us the power to be a different person. Do you believe that? Yes, God can give you the power to be a different person. And more than anything else, young people, I am praying that you will rise above the self-centeredness that is the major problem of Generation Y. Rise above your self-interest. I'm dreaming of the day when somebody will tell me, look at the Facebook accounts and the pages of AUP students. You don't have pictures there of what they eat, of what they dress, of their other things about themselves. You have pictures there of the activities wherein they serve others. You have pictures of the Voice of Youths that you join. This year, we will have 1 day of service to the community. All of us will go out and serve the community. Those pictures, images of self-sacrifice, service, commitment, dedication. Because you have so much potential, young people. So much potential. The church needs you. Live a simple lifestyle. Spend less time and money on self so you can have more time and resources for serving others. Even as you have a plan to help your family, have a plan too on how to help the church and how to help others. One thing, Dr. Bangloy, Dr. Salcor, that I admire in our older generation alumni. And I'm always encouraged when I meet with them. They are thinking so much how to be a blessing to their alma mater. They spend their own money, their own time, going to other alumni, raising money for our medicine program for the alumni hall. That's why we named it in their honor. That is the spirit we want to see. Sometimes, young people, I ask myself, 10 years from now, when your generation will be the time of building your careers, is there a place in your career path for the church? I'm not saying that you should all be employed by the church. Will there be teachers who will serve in the government, in our institutions, even though the salary is low? Will there be pastors? Will there be leaders to lead out in our institutions? Will there be? The answer is your generation. You. Oh yes, young people, give your life to the Lord today. Remember your Creator in the days or in the time when while you are young. Plant the spirit of service today. Do you remember the song, "We Are His Hands"? We are His hands to touch the world around us. We are His feet to go. We will sing it in a few minutes. To go where He may lead. We are His eyes to see the need in others. We are His voice to tell of His return. We are His love shining or burning in the darkness. We are His love shining in the night. Yes, young people, the greatest blessing in life is not for people to pay attention to us. The greatest happiness in life is to lose ourselves and pay attention and spend our lives in blessing others. That's the greatest happiness of all. Let me share with you a quotation that I found very useful. This is written by Jacques Ellul. He's a philosopher of culture. Let me read to you the quotation. Remember your Creator during your youth, when all possibilities lie open before you, and you can offer all your strength intact for God's service. The time to remember is not after you have become senile and paralyzed. No, not that time. Then, when you are old, it may not be too late for your salvation. Yes, salvation is always open, even when you are old. But it's too late for you to serve as the presence of God in the midst of the world and creation. You know the familiar... let me continue, Jacques Ellul. You must take sides earlier when you can actually make choices. Remember your Creator. When you may have many paths opening at your feet before the weight of necessity overwhelms you. Remember the familiar quotation of Ellen G. White. With such an army of workers as our who? Oh, let me ask again. With such an army of workers as our youth, that's you. Our youth, rightly trained, might furnish how soon the message of a crucified, risen, and soon coming Savior might be carried to the whole world. The future of God's work is in your hands. I do not know why He gave it to young people. If Jesus is coming in the next few years, it means it's your responsibility in the next few years. I do not know why He gave it to you with the weaknesses of the millennial generation. Maybe it's because you're optimistic. Maybe it's because you can invent new ways of winning people to the Lord Jesus Christ that we who are in the traditional mode may not even imagine or innovate. But God has given it to you because I believe Jesus is coming soon. You are the future of the church, young people. Yes, remember your Creator now. When? Now, today, while you are young, before all of the effects of life and the other stages of life come in, you remember your Creator. How many of you today will say, Lord, help me rise above my self-centeredness? How many of you young people would say, Lord, help me to use my talents not just to make me popular and well-known, but help me to forget myself so that others can know you? How many of you today, young people, would dedicate your life and say, Lord, my generation, me, for you, O Lord? If you are willing for such a commitment, and if you want to live your life for the service of the Master, our chorister will lead us in a song, We Are His Hands. If that is your commitment, anytime during the song, please stand up and sing the song from the bottom of your hearts and commit yourself to the Lord. You say, Lord, I remember, I am mindful, you are my Creator, accept me in your service.
We are His hands to touch the world around us. We are His feet to go where He may lead. And we are His love burning in the dark. To see the need in others, we are His voice to tell of His return, and we are His love burning in the dark.
This is your children. This is the generation who by faith will meet Jesus face to face, we believe. O Lord, help them rise above the selfishness, the self-centeredness, the pleasure-seeking direction of the world that they live in. And may they, through their commitment to you,
their love to you, their self-sacrificing love and service, prepare the world for Jesus' soon return. May you bless each one of them. Amen.
Let's thank the Lord for the privilege of worshiping Him through giving our tithes and offering. Before our deacons and deaconesses will receive our tithes and offering, we would like to answer this wonderful question. Where would be the safest place for your savings and treasure? One sister found an unusual place that wasn't a security box in the bank. The school at Heidelberg in California was desperately in need of money. Let's listen to Ellen G. White tell the story in her own words. Our supplication went up to heaven with many tears for the Lord to send us means. In about 3 hours' time, I heard a knock at my door. Upon opening it, I found a sister there. She said, "I do not wish to disturb you while writing, but I have some money that I want to invest in the cause." She gave to the college $5,000, and tears ran down her eyes. To think that she had now found a safe deposit for what so long been only a source of care and anxiety. This is found in the book, Next, Passion, Purpose, and Power, page 163. Today, let's think of investing in God's kingdom, which will pay dividends into eternity. Dear God, thank you for the privilege of being the answer to someone's prayer. As we give generously, please help our gifts to be a blessing to someone today. May our deacons and deaconesses receive our tithes and offering.
Thank you.
All rise.
Bless thou the gifts our hands have brought. Bless thou our work our hearts have. Ours is the faith, the will, the thought, the rest, O God, is in thy hand. Amen.
Here is now, O God, the gifts and offering presented to thy hand. Bless this, O loving Father, that it will help furtherance their work. In their Jesus' name.
Give of your best to the Master. Give of the strength of your youth. Throw your soul's fresh glowing ardor into the battle for truth. Jesus has set the example. Dauntless was he, young and brave. Give him your loyal devotion. Give him the best that you have. Give off your best to the Master. Give him first slave in your youth. Join in the battle for truth. Give off your best to the Master. Give him first place in your heart. Give him first place in your service. Consecrate every part. Given to you shall be given. God his beloved Son gave. Gratefully seeking to serve him. Give him the best that you have. Give off your best to the Master. Give off the strength of your youth. Clad in salvation's full armor. Join in the battle for truth. Give off your best to the Master. Naught else is worthy is love. He gave himself for your ransom. gave up his glory above, laid down to his life without murmur, you from sin's ruin to save. Give him your heart's adoration, give him the best that you have. Give off your best to the Master. Give of the strength of your youth, clad in salvation's full armor. Join in the battle for
young man, young woman, remember your Creator while you are young. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
This is the threefold truth on which our faith depends, and with this joyful cry, worship begins and ends. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. By this we are upheld when doubts and grief assail. Our Christian fortitude has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. This is the threefold truth, which if we hold it fast, changes the world and us, and brings us home at last. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again.
Happy Sabbath.